Oh, hi. Come in. Please, sit down. You're just in time for a wonderful story. It's about the Chincoteague ponies that run free on the island of Cezanne, which is located off the eastern shore of Virginia. There are many mysteries about these beautiful ponies. So sit back, relax, and let me tell you all about them. It all started a long, long time ago.
There are several theories concerning the somewhat mysterious origin of these ponies. The first theory suggests that the ponies are descendants of horses, which were hidden on the island by eastern shore colonists. These colonists would have unwittingly initiated this phenomenon with the primary purpose of seeking to evade taxation and fencing requirements. This theory is based upon the assumption that the ponies could take care of themselves while on the island and could be brought back to the mainland whenever needed. The second theory proposes a more intriguing possibility, namely that pirates left the ponies on the island, allowing the animals to graze. The pirates intended to return, as they so often did, to retrieve them. However, for some unknown reason, on one occasion, the pirates never returned to collect their charges, and the ponies have flourished ever since. The third and least communicated theory attributes the ponies' odd positioning to tragedy at sea. It is based on the premise of an English vessel being shipwrecked near the southern point of Cezanne. Under this scenario, the ponies aboard would have swum to safety while the European men were rescued by the island's native Indians. However, the most popular and romantic theory remains that which has been passed down throughout the years by the elder residents of Chincoteague. It is said that sometime during the 16th century, a Spanish galleon, the Chimino, was wrecked near the isolated barrier island. This ship was transporting rich cargo and fine ponies to the King of Spain. The Chimino was caught and ravaged by a terrible storm somewhere off the coast of Maryland. It is believed that the ponies somehow survived this peril, swam to shore, and have been there ever since. Although their means of arrival is inconclusive and often debated, the fact remains that these hardy little ponies have survived hardship and rigorous living on this barrier island. In some ways, the island itself is just as interesting as the ponies that roam it. Cezanne Island has not always been an island. Originally, it was the southern part of a long peninsula which extended north towards Delaware. In August of 1633, a violent storm ripped through the sandy beach, cutting away the southern end of Ocean City and forming it into a true island. The southern 13 miles are considered part of Virginia, and the northern 24 part of Maryland. Cezanne received its name from its native Indian inhabitants. Translated, the word means running stream in between. The first white man settlement occurred in 1688. It flourished until the population peaked, reaching 225 near 1890. The village population declined in 1922. In that year, most of the Virginian portion of Cezanne was acquired by a doctor from Baltimore, Maryland. After securing this land, he would not permit the villagers to cross his property, which is now known as Tom's Cove. Economically speaking, this area of land had been of prime importance to the villagers, who did most of their clamming there. Without access to this clamming bed, and unable to find other means of employment, the settlers were forced to move back to the mainland. In 1943, a national wildlife refuge was established. Backed by high ocean-made dunes, the land gives way to freshwater ponds, marshes, and tall pines, which are the only large trees on the island. Today, Assateague Island is a wildlife sanctuary. The marshes have become major feeding and nesting grounds for a vast assortment of birds, small game, and deer. Approximately 300 species of birds have been observed, and in 1923, a Boy Scout troop introduced the Japanese silka deer to the island. President Lyndon B. Johnson signed a bill in 1965 naming Assateague Island National Seashore, home of the wild ponies. At the time, he remarked, "If future generations are to remember us with gratitude, we must achieve more than a miracle of technology. We must also leave them a glimpse of the world as God really made it. Assateague is just that." Most historians concur that the ponies have lived on Assateague for 300 to 400 years. It is believed the original ponies were solid in color and more horse-like in size, over 14 hands tall. Various factors have influenced their evolution. Their marsh grass diet and brackish water supply no doubt contributed in part to their present smaller size. In addition to diet, man also played an important role in their history. 80 new ponies were added to the island's population by the resident firemen, who sought to increase the herd's size and dilute the effects of inbreeding. Some of these newcomers hailed from the wild Mustang herds of the West. This infusion of new stock has produced today's pinto and piebald ponies. In general, most horses could not endure life on this island, but these steadfast ponies have survived through years of adaptation. Their thick, furry coats and stockiness enable them to endure the harsh winters as well as the insects of summer. The average lifespan of an Assateague Island pony is approximately 20 years. The ponies have no natural predators living on the island. However, this youngster is investigating that theory for himself. The pony's staple diet consists of 80% grass, salt marsh and cord grass, and 20% American beach grass. Occasionally, they do enjoy a nibble of poison ivy, prickly green briar stem, and soft green sandbar thorn balls found growing in the dune grass. Although they naturally prefer fresh water, the ponies will, at times, drink some salt water. The ponies seem to wander aimlessly, but they all have a point and purpose. Whenever the skies darken with storm clouds, the ponies move as far away from the sea as they possibly can, venturing to the highest ground on the island. Perhaps they are remembering that legendary stormy day so long ago, which landed them in their present surroundings. Yet, despite the storms and the harsh environment, the herd lives on. The collective herd of approximately 150 does not run in large numbers. A single stallion, several mares, and their foals make up each of the many small bands that roam the island. The number of mares in a harem depends primarily on the stallion's fighting prowess and his ability to hold on to them. Whether the group is grazing, resting, or drinking, the ruling stallion is constantly on alert, watching over his mares. Sometimes a rogue stallion will swoop down upon a mare and her family, hoping to separate her from the others and creating a minor stampede in the process. In the midst of all the confusion, it is difficult for the harem's master to guard each and every one of his mares. It takes a fast and skillful challenger to drive a mare away from her herd. An intruder will sometimes be successful in stealing away his prize. If not, however, he will have to compete against the harem's leader. Unless the rival stallion is stronger, faster, and more alert than his opponent, he will be driven off, defeated, and mareless. Every pony knows its place within its group, since each group's social order is defined by a class structure. The dominant stallion feeds and drinks first, and is the leader in almost all other situations as well. The next in rank is the lead mare. She follows close behind Spring is known as the time of the stallions, since it is the season when mating mostly occurs. During this period, in addition to breeding, the young stallions of the herd must leave their respective families and attempt to form their own. The young stallions will either leave voluntarily or be driven off by the harem's master. These bachelors will usually form a temporary herd until they can establish harems of their own. The young stallions wait patiently until they are physically fit to challenge the harem stallions. An impregnated mare will stay with the herd until she is ready to foal. The gestation period is approximately 330 days. This is the only occasion on which a mare is permitted to leave the herd. She is allowed to give birth in a place of her choosing. As soon as it is born, a foal will try repeatedly to rise to its feet. Once standing, it will begin to nurse almost immediately. During the first month of its life, a foal will nurse from its mother up to 5 times per hour. The foal will usually continue to feed upon its mother's rich milk until the following spring. The youngster does, however, begin nibbling at grass within the first week of its being born. The foal will rest nearly 80% of the time, invariably, while lying down. Whenever it is not at rest, it is usually feeding. For the first 2 weeks, the bond between mother and newborn foal is extremely close. Indeed, the two are inseparable. A foal will trust its mother enough to lie beneath her for shade. This trust is well-founded. The maternal instinct is very strong as these mothers try to protect their offspring. Any unwelcome guest daring to venture too close will be warned, and if they continue to approach, will either be kicked or bitten until they respond accordingly to her threat. The foal, when nearly 1 month old, will begin to notice the other foals in the herd. It will start to wander from its mother, but never too far, extending the distance just a bit more each time. As summer passes, the foals spend more and more time away from their mothers. This is the season for their type of fun. They begin imitating their elders with mock fights, but this is all just in sport. The foals romp and gallop with each other, or sometimes just by themselves. After all the excitement of playing, they sleep collectively, soaking up the sun's rays together. On occasion, they will give each other an enjoyable back scratch, just one of the many ways in which they communicate with each other. They certainly have a good deal of history to discuss. Early in the 1920s, two serious fires ravaged Chincoteague, leveling much of the town. Citizens then realized that they desperately needed a fire department. In 1924, an official fire department was formed. Since that time, beginning in 1925, an annual carnival has been held to raise money for equipment and other essentials. During the 1800s, penning the ponies became necessary to maintain the size of the herd. This event was subsequently included in the festivities, coinciding with the carnival. This unique way of controlling overpopulation has become a steadfast tradition. The firemen have a deep sense of pride in these ponies. No wonder, since it is their help which has contributed to the herd's survival. The number of visitors to the refuge has increased 79% in just 2 years. These crowds include horse lovers, bird watchers, beachgoers, and of course, all around nature enthusiasts. The annual roundup for the carnival is conducted by the firemen, most often on the weekend before the swim. Volunteers from miles around join the firemen for this event. It is a true tradition to many of these cowboys. The firemen and cowboys gather before dawn to take advantage of the cool morning air. Their riding horses are taken by trailer to Assateague Island, unloaded and readied for their busy day. The ponies are first herded on the northern end of the island. This is a section of land which is open only to hikers and not seen by most visitors. Some of the older ponies sense what is about to happen, and there is a flourish of galloping. However, these cowboys have been doing this for some time. The ponies are finally overtaken and herded into a holding pen, there to spend the night. The next morning, at dawn, the ponies are herded southward along the coast. It was a fascinating scene this year, viewed through the rolling fog and sea mist. Surrounded by the riding steeds, these ponies hardly put up any fight. They seem to enjoy their early morning trek along the cool sands of the beach.
Thank you. How you doing?
This group of ponies is brought to the southern end of the island, where they are put into a second corral. Once in a while, some ponies will outsmart these cowboys. Feeling rather lucky, these ponies will miss out on this year's swim. Herding on this southern end of the island is a bit more difficult, since the cowboys must make allowance for the crowds which have converged there to see the big event. By Tuesday afternoon, the roundup is completed, and the ponies anxiously await their big day. Although the mares usually give the cowboys little trouble once in the corral, the stallions sometimes become aggressive. The corral is a lively and interesting place. The activities within range from complacent eating, drinking, and dozing, to friendly backbiting, to stallions stealing about, preventing their mares from wandering too far. The annual carnival and pony swim has grown tremendously in popularity. It has found both national and some international fame due to human interest and love for these island ponies. The carnival is held during the last 2 weeks of July, with the pony swim traditionally scheduled on the last Wednesday of the month. The swim invariably takes place in the morning, since it is planned for the earliest slack tide. During this slack tide, the water is still, making it easier for the ponies to swim across the channel. The average break in the current's flow lasts for only 15 minutes, and therefore, timing is very important. Long before the swim begins, the crowds gather. Despite the rain, which ushered in the day, an estimated 40,000 people attended this year's event. The crowd grows restless as horse lovers from all across the nation swarm to the general area. Some observers spill over onto the channel shore, hoping to get a better view. The waterway is also laden with boats, and the onlookers aboard are eagerly awaiting the big event. The spectators cheer as the first pony hits the water and the herd begins its annual swim. The distance between shores is roughly a quarter of a mile. It takes between 7 and 10 minutes for the first pony to crest the mainland's beach. It is amazing to behold the young colts as they swim alongside their mothers, especially when one considers that, for some, it is their first time in the water. Some foals are as young as 2 days old, but they do not swim the channel. These infants are loaded onto trailers and transported to the carnival ground. The average age of the new foals at the time of their crossing the channel is 7 to 8 weeks. If you observe closely enough, It appears as though some of these colts actually ride across the waterway on the backs of their mothers. The first young pony to land on shore is crowned King or Queen Neptune and will be given away at the carnival grounds that afternoon. Roughly 135 wild ponies swam the channel this year. The herd is then rested for nearly half an hour in a roped-off enclosure. The crowd watches over the proceedings as the ponies are examined by a veterinarian. Once the ponies are well rested, they are again herded. This time, they are on their way to their final destination, the carnival grounds. They are driven down the streets of Chincoteague, through the crowds on the sidewalk, which have awaited their procession. Some of these ponies are old pros at this parade. In fact, a common joke on the island is that even if the firemen did not round up the herd one year, the ponies would swim the channel by themselves. Once at the carnival grounds, the herd again attempts to regroup. By this time, the ponies have adjusted well to their situation, and there is less fighting among the stallions. In previous years, hot iron branding was included in the day's schedule of events. Thankfully, that procedure has been discontinued. However, if you look very carefully, you can still see the telltale branded F, which stood for firemen, on some of the older ponies. Now is the time for King or Queen Neptune to be given away. The crowd gathers with their tickets in hand, each holder hoping that theirs will be the winner. This year's lucky recipient decided to give her filly back to the Chincoteague Fire Department, allowing the pony to live its life on Assateague Island. She is believed to be the first Queen Neptune ever returned to the wild. Wednesday night is one of the most celebrated nights of the carnival. While the ponies rest after their big day, the crowd turns its attention to enjoying the festivities. In 1947, author Marguerite Henry published Misty of Chincoteague, her first book about the Assateague pony. It quickly became a bestseller and is still popular today. The book is sold in many of the shops on the island. Evidently, when Marguerite Henry wrote Misty of Chincoteague, Misty became a local celebrity. In 1961, 20th Century Fox produced a movie based on this book, elevating Misty to the ranks of international fame and stardom. Most of the movie footage was shot on location on both Chincoteague and Assateague Islands. As a result of the movie's success, Misty left her hoofprint in the cement in front of Grom's Chinese Theater. The impression remains there to date. The auction of young colts begins at 8 o'clock on Thursday morning. The patrons attending this year's auction were honored with a visit from some of Misty's descendants. Separating the colts from their mothers can be sad. However, selling the ponies to people who will love them is, by comparison, a very kind and humane way of caring for the wild herd. If this event did not take place, the herd would soon overpopulate itself on the island, and many animals would starve.
And I'll tell you one thing, that just shows you what a $100 investment can do. I won't tell you secrets. Hey, but I'll tell you what, folks, that was one of the higher ponies that's been sold here, but I'll tell you what, it shows that if you take it home and groom it and feed it, that's what you can get. That's a $10,000 pony anywhere you go in the country, folks. And I'll tell you one thing, last year when he bought it, people were saying, oh, that's a pretty pony, but I'll tell you one thing, it's not a pretty pony, that's a beautiful pony. That is gorgeous. And I'll tell you one thing, it tickles me to death when people come back over here and show stuff. I hear so many tales about, oh, this, that, and the other. That's what Chincoteague ponies look like, folks, right there. And he'll handle these ponies. I know y'all think that you just get up here and muscle them. You don't. It's an art to handle these ponies. When one pulls back on you, you don't pull against him. You got to let up on his head. You got to ease up so he'll go on and stand up. These ponies, these boys know what they're doing. These guys aren't here year after year because we pick them up off the street. These are professionals. These guys know what they're doing. Huh. They're going to ask me for something big after this to give them all that boost. But all right, what are we going to do here? Let's sell this thing. Maybe I thought y'all work harder next time. All right, what do you want to give for this beautiful little pony right here? 202 places, that's 400. One gets it for 6 months, the other one gets it for 6 months. Go get 250 and break your tie. Yeah. 250, 300. 250, $300 bid. $300 bid, 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 We're not selling one, two, little David's problem. We're selling it to you now. You're walking around a time or two to let everybody get a chance to get a picture.
Later that evening, visitors may participate in the wild pony ride. On Friday morning, the direction of the swim is reversed. The huge crowds have somewhat dwindled, but there are still many spectators. The ponies swim back to the island most willingly, knowing that they are on their way home. The annual excitement and activities do not seem to bother them much. Yet, they are quite anxious to return to their natural habitat and to resume their daily routines for another year, until next spring. Then, there will be new colts, and new crowds, and the herd will do it all again.
Wonderful story. I hope you enjoyed it. Until next time.